sit down after Rock of Ages? Huh? Can we sit down after Rock of Ages and stuff?
Yeah. Yeah, for the prelude.
You know what I found out last week?
My boyfriend went and watched the live stream, and he said these mics are on before the service, and he could hear the entire conversation. So whoever's listening to the live stream right now, hello. Welcome. They can hear us.
I didn't just hear you through the mic.
For all the fathers out there, happy Father's Day.
But it's in the live stream, too, because I could hear my whole conversation about the countdown and how it wasn't there last week. Verse, chorus, I'll do the intro. We're ready.
Good morning and welcome to New Life Presbyterian Church. We're glad that you're here joining us on this beautiful morning. If you're new to New Life, welcoming you here in the sanctuary, or if you're joining online, we are glad that you're with us. If you are new, we invite you to fill out a connection card. You can find them online on the church's website, newlifepca.org. Or you can find them in the seats in front of you, and you can drop them off at the desk in the lobby there. That helps us get to know you a little bit better. It gives us an opportunity to pray for you if you have particular requests. So, as the Lord God does every single Sunday morning, he calls us by his word. This morning we hear his call from Revelation chapter 19, verses 6 through 7. Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, "Hallelujah! For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exalt and give him the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready." Let's open in prayer. Hallelujah, Almighty God. Already this morning, we've seen your grace and that you've brought us together to worship you here. May our worship this morning give you glory, and we ask that your Spirit would lead us and that we would find joy and comfort in you. Amen.
Please stand as we open with song.
maker of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Eddie Slavin, and my wife and I are co-chairs of the Outreach Committee. At the beginning of the year, New Life decided that we would have a monthly event each month, and this would allow us an opportunity to invite our family and our friends into the church. And it'd be a little bit of a less threatening situation, because sometimes it's hard for people to come into a new church. This way, they would get to know us a little bit before we invite them into church on a Sunday morning. And so this coming Sunday is going to be one of those special events. It's going to be called Silly Safaris. How many have ever seen Silly Safaris? Raise your hand. Well, there's been a few people. It's really a neat program. They bring in live animals, okay? And what they do is they show a program, and this program in particular is called God Made All the Animals. It's really cute. You'll love it. It's for children of all ages, okay? So it's a great opportunity to invite our family and friends, and that's why we want to do this. We want to be intentional each month about inviting our family and our friends to these events. So we hope to see you next Sunday at 9 o'clock in the Fellowship Hall. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Eddie. Before going to the pastoral prayer this morning, as we do every week, a reminder of the different ways that we can give our tithes and our offerings. So using the app, online, through text, or the old-fashioned way by putting a check in a basket or mailing it to the church. All of those ways, we just continue to encourage you to be faithful givers, particularly here during the summer months. If you're anything like me, you know, on vacation every couple of weekends or out of town every couple of weekends, sometimes it slips my mind not coming to church. So I just encourage you to keep your tithes and your offerings at the forefront. This morning in prayer, we'll be lifting several things up, actually, but a couple of announcements before praying. Kyrie Lewis will be moving to Indianapolis soon, so this is her last Sunday with us this morning, so we'll be praying for her. Also, Paul Addington, yep, I see Paul back there. This is his last Sunday here in church before leaving for Lithuania, so we'll be giving God thanks for both of them, the blessing that they've been to our church, and then also prayers for them and their new endeavors. Also, Jerry and Elizabeth Immel had a baby boy very early this morning. The baby weighs 3 pounds and 7 ounces, so it is in the NICU. Jerry's communicated that the doctor's still working on the baby and they're not out of the woods yet. So, of course, we rejoice in the birth of this baby, but we're going to plead with God that his healing hand works through the physicians and the nurses to sustain that little baby. This morning, we'll be praying over our core value of evangelism, among some other prayer requests as well. So please join me in prayer. Father God, holy is your name. You are great, you're powerful, you're perfect, and yet you love us. In spite of our willful sinfulness, you love us, and through Christ, you've made us your own. We rejoice in this gospel, and we want to spread this news throughout our community, throughout the world, as individuals and as a church, and through the people that we support. We pray that as a church, we would display grace and truth, and that we as individuals would do the same in word and in deed. We pray for all the missionaries we support, for the Files in Japan, the Lees in Panama, the DeHarts in the Asian Crescent, the Schumachers in Croatia, as well as the group from here at New Life, working with them right now in Croatia, the Senses in the Czech Republic, Cody Probst serving as a chaplain in the Navy, and for the Winningers and Peter McFarland as they raise support with the hope of being sent out as missionaries in the near future. We also pray for the groups who reach people on college campuses, for RUF, crew, and the navigators. Lord, whether it's us in our neighborhoods, people on college campuses, or missionaries in the countries around the globe, we know that this world is in desperate need of the gospel. So we pray for strength, humility, and faithfulness for all of these people, these groups spreading your gospel. And we ask that you would soften the hearts of the people that hear their words. Father, we pray for our youth groups, particularly the junior high groups, they leave for the EDGE conference next weekend. May that be an exciting time for them and an edifying experience. We pray this week for the PCA General Assembly. We ask that all of those in attendance would faithfully do your work for the church. We give thanks this morning for Kyrie Lewis and the blessing that she's been to this church, especially our children. We rejoice that she's found a teaching job, and we pray for a smooth transition as she moves down to Indianapolis. And we also give you thanks for Paul Addington and the great blessing that he's been to us over the last several years, for who he is as a person, and for his work and his talents that he's led us in worship week after week. We pray for him as he moves to Lithuania and all the stresses and burdens that come with the excitement of moving to a new place. This morning, Father, we lift up to you several members of our church family. We rejoice in the gift of a new baby boy for the Immels, but with that joyfulness, we ask for your powerful healing hand. Be with the physicians, the nurses, and the rest of the team as they care for this child. We plead to you that his life would be preserved, and we ask for strength and trust and peace in this time for Jerry and Elizabeth and the whole family. We pray for Bobby Greer adjusting to suddenly losing sight in one eye, and for Jenai Gonzalez recovering from surgery on one of her arms. And finally, God, this morning, we give thanks for all of the fathers here today, for the blessings that they are to their families and that they've been to us. We pray that you continue to work in them to be a blessing to their families, be a blessing to their children, and that they would be a good demonstration of your love and your truth. We also, Lord, lift up all of those for whom today is a painful day, whether that's because of loss of a father, or bad memories or hurt through a father, or for those who have unfulfilled hopes to be a father. We lift all of them up to you, God. We pray for Bob coming up momentarily to lead us through the preaching of your word. We ask that your word would convict us, that your word would remind us of the great grace that you have for your people. And we ask that it would be a preparation as we move into the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, where we will see and feel your grace. For all of these things, Lord, and in all of these things, we ask that your will would be done and your kingdom would come. In the name of Christ alone we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Brandon, for leading us in prayer. This is Communion Sunday. That means we will not be dismissing children for Children's Church. However, before the sermon begins, we'd love to have a few moments with the children down front. So parents, if you want to dismiss your children, kids, you can come down to the center aisle here, and we'll talk for just a couple of minutes. Guys, get nice and close. It's good. I like that. Good morning, kids. Good to see you all. Did you hear what Mr. Slavin just told us about what's coming up next week? What's going to happen next week, next Sunday? Yeah. Silly safaris. That's right. That's going to be happening next Sunday. I can't wait. I love animals. I don't know. Do you guys love animals? Yeah? Yeah?
We adopted a dog and two cats adopted us.
You adopted a dog and two cats adopted you. Is that what you said?
Cats just stay at your house.
They just stay at your house. They just kind of come and hang out, huh? Yeah. So they're your pets now. How many of you have pets at home? Okay? What kind of pets do you have? Just yell it out. What do you have?
Cow.
Dog? Cow? Yeah. Your cat died. Cows, okay, pigs. I probably shouldn't have said yell that all out. That kind of created a little chaos. Okay, so we got dogs and cats. Anybody have a pet different than a dog, a cat, or a cow, or a pig? Gerbil and snake? Okay, that's great. We have a dog at home. Mary and I do. This is our dog. His name is Riley, and he's a border collie, and he's about almost 11 years old, and he loves to play frisbee, and he loves to swim in the water. We have a little pool in the backyard, and we fill it up, particularly in the summer, and he loves to swim. So we love our dog, and almost everybody loves animals, don't they? Where do animals come from? Yeah, that's right, God. That's the name of the Silly Safaris event next week, is God made all the animals. And do you know that the Bible actually refers to animals quite a bit? Can you think of some examples in the Bible where we see a story about animals or a mention of animals? Okay, very, very good. When they sacrifice a lamb, yeah, in the back. Noah and the fish? You mean Jonah and the fish? Okay, yeah, that's a really good example. Jonah and the big whale, yeah? Yeah, that's right. God created them all in the very beginning, yeah?
Noah's Ark.
Noah's Ark, yeah. That's probably the example that people remember the most. Is that what you were going to say, Clark? Yeah, okay. yeah, we saw all kinds of animals. Yeah, Alice?
When Jesus was entering the place, he was riding on a donkey.
Yeah, that's right. Very good. When he was entering Jerusalem, when he was preparing to go to the cross, he was riding on a donkey. Yeah, those are all great examples. Anything else? I think that's pretty much most of the ones that I had, actually. Balaam, the story of Balaam, and he was with a what kind of animal was that? Do you remember? A donkey, that's right. Yeah, Clark?
Well, yeah, I don't remember.
You don't remember, okay, yeah. Okay, and so how about Daniel? Daniel was in a den with some what?
Lions,
yeah, those aren't very nice lions, not an animal you would want to have for a pet, but God delivered him. So yeah, the Bible talks a lot about animals. What is the difference between human beings and animals? Yeah.
God created human beings in His own spirit.
Yeah, well, that's very good. Yeah, He created us in His own image, right? In His own image. Yeah. Okay, people have souls, animals do not. Yeah, so there's definitely a difference. We love the animals are gifts to us, and we can even learn things about God from the animals, but we're different because we're made in the image of God. Yeah, okay, so one last question. I think somebody actually already mentioned it, but what animal reminds you of Jesus?
Donkey.
Okay, a donkey, you rode in on a donkey, but what else? Yeah.
A lamb.
Sheep. Or sheep, lamb. Why do you say that? Okay, yeah. So we're the sheep. The Bible, Jesus talks about us as sheep, but then, yeah, Jesus is compared to a lamb because He is the Lamb of God who does what? The Lamb of God who takes away
our sins.
That's right, yeah. So just as lambs were used to be sacrificed in the Old Testament to forgive sins, Jesus comes and describes Himself, or is described as a lamb Himself, because He would go to the cross to sacrifice Himself to forgive our sins. So we can see animals, at least lambs in particular, have great significance for us. So here's my challenge to you guys. I'm going to ask you to do something this week. Would you think of one person, a friend of yours, that you can invite to Silly Safaris next Sunday? Will you do that? One person who doesn't go to the church. If you have friends outside the church, think of one person and ask them if they'll come next Sunday. Okay? Is that fair? Can you do that? All right, thumbs up. Great. Okay, let's pray. God in heaven, thank You so much for our children, and thank You for the gift of animals. Help us, Lord, to care for the animals that You have entrusted us to care for. And Lord, I pray that You would bless these children now as they remain in this sanctuary and hear Your word preached. Do a great work by Your Spirit in their hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, you guys can go back. Okay, please open your Bibles, everybody, to the book of Mark, chapter 2. We're looking at verses 13 to 28 this morning, Mark 2, 13 to 28. Brandon prayed for General Assembly coming up this week, and so that is the annual business meeting of our denomination, General Assembly. It's going to be held in Birmingham, Alabama this year. It moves from city to city, from year to year, and I appreciate the church's willingness to send Mary and me there, and so we will be leaving tomorrow to travel to Birmingham, and we'll be there for the entire week. Festivities or activities start on Tuesday night, and it lasts through Thursday night, maybe Friday morning if we have more business to do. So a lot happens at General Assembly. We vote on overtures that come before us that have been sent up from our presbyteries. We hear reports from our denominational agencies. We have worship services together. There are seminars. It's really a wonderful week, and we're expecting record attendance this year. We broke the record attendance last year when we had about 2,000 pastors and elders show up, and they're expecting more than that this year. Some controversial things before us, and so I think that's probably why so many people are registering and planning to come. So I just want to let you know about that. That's where Mary and I will be. Would appreciate your prayers for the denomination, for our deliberations and our fellowship together. And if you want to watch what happens, you can do that. And so an email was sent to you this morning, and there's a prayer request there, I believe, for the General Assembly. There's a link that you can go to watch by live stream what happens. And I think that probably won't start till Wednesday. So most activity is Wednesday afternoon and all day Thursday. So if you're interested in that kind of thing, take a look at that email this morning, and you can join us remotely this week. All right, Mark chapter 2. You know, it is often said, I think, and probably with good reason, conventional wisdom tells us that when you're with other people or you're at a dinner party or some kind of social engagement, that there are two things you never talk about, right? Religion and politics. Some families are different, and maybe they like to tangle on those things, but generally speaking, people tend to kind of avoid those topics, and the reason why is because it very often leads to disagreements and arguments and conflict and controversy. And there are not many of us who just love to seek out controversy and want to enter into it. Most of us tend to want to keep the peace and avoid the tension that comes with disagreement. Well, there was somebody in the Bible, actually, who seemed to always be at the center of controversy, and that person is Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus was a lightning rod for controversy. He was constantly in conflict, and unfortunately, sometimes people can notice this in the Scriptures and think that it gives them permission then to be argumentative and divisive. Sometimes this reality can kind of pour gasoline on that fire, and that would be an unfortunate conclusion to draw. We are commanded in Scripture not to be argumentative. Blessed are the peacemakers, Jesus says. But as is so often the case when we look at the Scriptures, we're kind of trying to balance truths. On the one hand, yeah, we're to be peacemakers. On the other hand, there's no denying that Jesus was constantly in the center of conflict and controversy. And R.C. Sproul says it this way: Jesus' life was a storm of controversy. The apostles, like the prophets before them, could hardly go a day without controversy. To avoid controversy is to avoid Christ. We can have peace, but it is a servile and carnal peace when, or if it's happening, when truth is slain in the streets. So we are in a sermon series here going through the Gospel of Mark, calling this the Servant King. We're looking at the life of Jesus, the Servant of King, Servant King. And we're just looking at how Jesus relates to a variety of issues. Last week it was Jesus and forgiveness, and we saw Jesus' authority to forgive sins. And so this week we're looking at Jesus and controversy. And you might remember from last week that the controversy already began in last week's text. Remember when Jesus was speaking to the paralytic and talking about being able to forgive sins? The scribes were there and they were saying, "Who is this fellow and what is he talking about? He's acting like he can forgive sins. This is blasphemy." And so last week, the controversy, the conflict was already beginning. I mentioned it last week that this is a theme that's going to continue throughout the book of Mark. And in our passage today, we're just going to see it show up repeatedly here. And so we're going to look at three examples of controversy that Jesus finds himself involved in. So if you're able to stand, please do that now. And I'm going to read Mark 2, starting with verse 13, going to the end of the chapter. Mark 2:13, controversy. Jesus went out again beside the sea, and all the crowd was coming to him, and he was teaching them. And as he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax booth. And he said to him, "Follow me." And he rose and followed him. And as he reclined at table in his house, many tax collectors and sinners were reclining with Jesus and his disciples, and there were many who followed him. And the scribes of the Pharisees, when they saw that he was eating with sinners and tax collectors, said to his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" And when Jesus heard it, he said to them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, I came not to call the righteous, but sinners." Now John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting, and people came and said to him, "Why do John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast?" And Jesus said to them, "Can the wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast in that day. No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. If he does, the patch tears away from it, the new from the old, and a worse tear is made. And no one pours new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is destroyed, and so are the skins. But new wine is for fresh wineskins." One Sabbath, he was going through the grain fields, and as they made their way, the disciples began to pluck heads of grain. And the Pharisees were saying to him, "Look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?" And he said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he was in need and was hungry, he and those who were with him, how he entered the house of God in the time of Abiathar the high priest and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priest to eat, and also gave it to those who were with him?" And he said to them, "The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath." Holy Spirit, please come. Open our eyes to behold wonderful things in your word. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. So, let's look at Jesus' connection to controversy here this morning. And we're going to look at this in three ways, of course. We've got a controversy about feasting, and then a controversy about fasting, and then a controversy about resting. So, these are the three things we're considering. So, first of all, let's consider the controversy about feasting. Now, when I say feasting here, I don't mean necessarily regarding any of the food that Jesus was eating, but instead the people with whom Jesus was feasting or eating. That's the nature of the controversy here. And so, starting with verse 13, we see Jesus continuing with his teaching ministry, and as he passes by, we see that he notices this man named Levi and calls Levi to follow him. So here we're seeing Jesus is continuing to call disciples to himself. He's continuing to build this group of disciples, which will eventually be 12 main disciples. But you might remember chapter 1, we saw that Jesus had already chosen four men, two sets of brothers to himself, and he called them to follow him, and they rose and followed him, just like Levi is doing here in this text. Immediately he follows Jesus. And so Levi is now the fifth disciple called. No controversy in calling fishermen to be your disciples, but there is something controversial here because Levi is not a fisherman, he is a tax collector. And we know that because it says here in verse 14, Levi, the son of Alphaeus, was sitting at the tax booth. Now, the reason that this is controversial is because there was nobody who was despised and hated more in Jewish society than a tax collector. Now, remember, the Jews are living under the occupation of the Roman Empire, and the Romans would tax their subjects even through Jewish authority. So King Herod was in charge of taxes, but only because the Roman authority was over him. And then Herod would send out tax collectors like this man Levi to go out and collect taxes. So Levi here is representing this hated enemy of the people of God. People would regard him as a collaborator with the enemy. So the Jews hated tax collectors. But not only for that, but tax collectors had a reputation for being very corrupt. They would just charge whatever they wanted. Very often they would charge more than necessary, and they would just skim the amount off the top for themselves. And it was very rare to find an honest tax collector. And so tax collectors were hated. And now here is Jesus saying, "This tax collector, I want you to be my disciple." It's a controversial decision. By the way, referring to Levi here, if you go to Matthew 9:9, which gives another depiction of this story, he's called Matthew there. And so just like Simon's name was changed to Peter, perhaps Levi's name was also changed to Matthew. But we believe Levi is actually Matthew. So story continues. We see some tension building already. Jesus calling a tax collector. Then verse 15, we see that Jesus is feasting. He's reclining at table, it says, in his house. Reclining at table. That's just a reference to having a meal together. The way they would eat in ancient times is you'd have a table in the middle, and then there would be couches around the table. The food would be on the table, and people would just kind of kick back and lie down rather than sitting like we might. They would kind of lie down while they ate. And so here Jesus is reclining at table. And then if you look at verse 15, notice that it's not just one tax collector that he likes to hang out with. There are many at this dinner. Many tax collectors, and not just tax collectors, but sinners as well. Sinners, you know, a very broad term that we would think of now. Sinners then probably referred more to just people who were outside the covenant community, had no interest in God's law, just, you know, unbelievers, outsiders, outcasts, not necessarily people of any kind of extreme immorality, just people who didn't have a place within the covenant community. And so they are there as well. And so, you know, this is noticed. Jesus hanging out with tax collectors and sinners. Verse 16, the scribes of the Pharisees, when they saw that he was eating with sinners and tax collectors, says, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" They're scandalized by this. I mean, this is just shocking to them. It's totally unacceptable for a religious leader of Jesus' reputation to be spending time with these kinds of people. I mean, today, you know, we value diversity today, and so it's not that unusual to see people hanging out with people different than them. We kind of understand that's generally a good thing. It just wasn't understood as a good thing in this time. And the fact that Jesus is having a meal with them is even more significant because, you know, again, today in this day and age, we're so used to fast food. You know, you just run through the drive-thru and get some food and eat in your car. Or at the very least, you know, you run in and you eat your taco, and there's nothing formal. There's nothing significant. It doesn't really mean anything except that you're hungry. But back then, when you would recline at table with people, what that meant is I'm connecting with you. I am identifying with you. I want to walk through life with you. I'm making a connection with you. And the Pharisees see this, and they're just like, this is unacceptable. Now, the Pharisees, first time the Pharisees are mentioned here in the book of Mark. And so Pharisees were kind of an unusual group. Pharisee actually means separatist. So they kind of kept themselves separate from particularly ritual uncleanness. They weren't priests. They weren't, you know, vocational priests. religious authorities, but they were a group of laymen who were absolutely devoted and committed to following the scriptures and every jot and tittle, and they were so concerned that everybody do that as well that they set up a whole bunch of rules and regulations to try to make sure that nobody would disobey the Bible. And so we have to respect that intention anyway. I mean, the Pharisees had a good desire in mind. They want to see people obey the scriptures. They don't want to see that violated, but they would go too far and they would come up with all of these rules. It would be like an example, if you could think about the Garden of Eden and Adam and Eve ate the fruit, and it would be like the Pharisees would have reacted to that and said, okay, let's build a big wall around all gardens and make sure that no one ever goes into a garden ever again because the potential exists that you might take some fruit off a tree that you shouldn't have and eat it. So we'll just deny everybody the enjoyment of any garden in any place to make this protection. You know, again, the intent is good, but it's just way over the top. And so that's what's partially happening here. The Pharisees are seeing Jesus hanging out with these tax collectors and sinners, and they're scandalized. So Jesus has a response. Here's one thing you'll notice very often is that when Jesus is in the middle of controversy, very rarely, I don't think any time, does he say, sorry, yeah, I shouldn't have really said it that way. Here, let me back up. Let me walk that back a little bit and rephrase it for you. Oh, no, I didn't mean that. I didn't mean this. I mean, most of the time when Jesus is in controversy, he just kind of turns up the heat. You know, he just does not back off. And so we're seeing that in all these incidents. And so when these Pharisees challenged Jesus, verse 17, when Jesus heard it, he says to them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick." So the point he's making here is that it's very natural for doctors to hang out with sick people. You know, imagine you call your doctor, "I need to make an appointment," and they say, "Are you feeling bad?" And you say, "Well, yeah. Oh, sorry, we don't make appointments with sick people." You'll have to go somewhere else. You know, I mean, your first reaction would be, get a new doctor. This is absurd. This is what a doctor is supposed to do. And what Jesus is saying here is, this is my mission. My mission is to come for tax collectors and sinners, for people who are sick, for people who are a mess, for people who are outcasts, for people who are not accepted, for the people that no one wants to be with. Those are the people I want to be with. That's what Jesus is saying. I'm coming for the sick, not for the healthy. That there is just a great challenge for us, friends, because it is all of our tendencies, mine included, to hang out and gravitate toward people who think like us and dress like us and look like us and believe like us and behave like us. And when people look, act, think differently, we look the other way. We just don't want the discomfort. But that's not the way Jesus lived. He hung out with people different than him. Tax collectors and sinners, and the fact that it scandalized the people viewing him did not matter to him a bit. Paul says this later in Romans 12, "Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly." You know, you hear me pretty frequently with some regularity, I know from this pulpit, that I will challenge the views we hear in the culture about LGBT stuff and homosexuality, and I'm firmly convinced that the Scripture does not condone that behavior at all. And so as it comes up in the Scriptures, we're going to talk about that, and you hear it, and I hope that our position, my position on that is clear to you. But I hope that you would never understand me to be saying that because we disagree with their view or their practice, that somehow means you shouldn't love them or be with them or hang out with them or work with them or be neighbors with them. Christians should be the very first people to come along somebody in the LGBT community and befriend and love and care and serve them. We're not to look the other way. We're not to ostracize them from our community or from our friendship. We're not to be afraid if they move in next door. You're not to get creeped out if they're in the cubicle next to you at work. We're to reach out to these people with love. That doesn't mean we condone their behavior, but the fact that we don't condone their behavior doesn't mean that we should step away from them in our lifestyle. That's not what Jesus would do. He hung out with tax collectors and sinners, and that's controversial. And if you follow that lead, you're going to find controversy. There's people in the church probably who won't like that, and you're going to have to respond to that, but that's the model that Jesus is setting for us. So that's a controversy about feasting. But there's also a controversy here about fasting. Starting with verse 18, the disciples of John and the Pharisees are said in verse 15 to be fasting. They're fasting. But Jesus' disciples are not fasting. And so this also is noticed. And so it says here that people are coming in verse 18, and they're asking, why did John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples don't fast, Jesus? So they're not really pointing the finger at Jesus here as to whether he's fasting. They just see that his disciples aren't fasting, and they're saying, you know, Jesus, you're their leader, so you're responsible. So how come your disciples don't fast? Now, first of all, you might say, well, what is fasting? So fasting can be defined like this. Keep looking the wrong way here. Fasting, the voluntary denial of a normal function for the sake of intense spiritual activity. That's fasting. Now, notice this is a broad definition, denial of a normal function. Normally, we think of fasting as having something to do with denying ourselves food, and that's certainly correct. You know, the word breakfast is breaking a fast. You know, you haven't eaten through the night. You've been fasting, in a sense, and when you get up and have your first meal of the day, you're breaking that fast, so we call it breakfast. But a fast can apply not just to food, but to other things, like I'm going to stop buying this thing, or I'm going to fast from my phone for a little while. You know, any kind of normal function for the sake of spiritual activity or growth can be fasting. And so probably fasting from food is what is in mind here in this text. And fasting is something that was only commanded actually once a year in the Old Testament during the Day of Atonement, so only really a requirement for the people of God to fast just one time a year. So other fasting that would take place would be just kind of voluntary fasting that the people of God would engage in as they were led by the Lord. So just the Bible, just one time, Old Testament, one time a year fasting. But here's what the Pharisees did. They said you got to fast twice a week, not twice a year, okay? Twice a year would be twice as much as what God required. Twice a week. We see this in Luke 18. You remember this story of the Pharisee and the tax collector? It says the Pharisee, he's standing by himself, and he prays to God and says, oh, God, I thank you. I'm not like other men. I'm not like all these bad people. I'm not like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. So this is what marked the Pharisee, you know. They came up with these agreements, these rules, these prohibitions, and these prohibitions would kind of get equal authority to the Scriptures themselves, and they were fervently devoted to them. And so the idea here, the concern, the controversy in this passage is, Pharisees are fasting twice a week, Jesus' disciples aren't fasting twice a week, so what's the matter, Jesus' disciples? Are you guys not serious? You're not devoted like the Pharisees are. You clearly aren't as serious about your faith. They're doing this twice a week. You're not doing it at all. Now, one interesting question that should be raised here is, how do people know that the Pharisees' disciples and John's disciples are fasting? I mean, how does anybody know when you fast? How is that seen? It's not seen unless you tell them, unless you say, hey, I'm fasting this week. I just want you to know that so that you're impressed. I don't know how anybody really knows, except they're making a big deal out of it, and so that's apparently what the Pharisees' disciples and John's disciples are doing, making a big deal. Everybody knows they're fasting, but not Jesus' disciples. So here's how Jesus answers, starting here in verse 19. So he says some things here that maybe sound confusing on the surface. First of all, he talks about a wedding. And he says, can wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. So he's just thinking of a wedding. And, you know, a wedding is very different than a spiritual discipline like fasting. You know, fasting brings a certain level of discomfort. You know, it's not always a super pleasant thing to do, particularly if it's an extended fast and you're going days without food. That's more of a more of a kind of a solemn, difficult thing. And what Jesus is saying is, he's drawing a comparison to a wedding, which is not a solemn, difficult thing. A wedding is a happy, joyful thing. And so the comparison that he's drawing here is between himself and the bridegroom. He's saying at a wedding feast, the bridegroom's there. And when the bridegroom is there, they're not fasting, they're feasting. They're rejoicing, they're having a great time because the groom is there. And what Jesus is implying here is that I am here. And when I am here with my disciples, there is no reason for them to fast. This is a time for them to be joyful because the Messiah, the Savior of the world, is in their midst. Now, he goes on in verse 20 and he says the days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them. And so I think Jesus here is giving a hint at his own death. The time is coming. Well, he'll be taken away. He'll be nailed to a cross. And then they'll fast. So this is not a denial of the value of fasting. What Jesus is just saying is that Jesus is here, and so this is a time for celebration. The disciples shouldn't be fasting now. They should be rejoicing. And then he goes on, and he uses kind of two illustrations. And so the first one here is in verse 21. He says, no one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. If he does, the patch tears away from it, the new from the old, and a worse tear is made. And so what he's saying here is that, you know, if you have a garment, you know, something that you wear, you've worn it for a long time, you've washed it over and over again, it's shrunk, but it's shrunk as much as it's going to shrink, and there's a tear in it, and then you get a new patch, an unshrunk cloth is a patch, you get a patch and it's never been washed, so it's not shrinking, and then you put that on the hole, what's going to happen is when you wash the whole thing now, that new patch is going to shrink, and the old garment is not going to shrink. And when the patch shrinks, it's going to end up tearing away from that hole, and it's going to make the whole problem worse. That's the illustration. No, nobody does that. You don't take old patches and sew it to, you don't take new patches and sew it to old garments. That's the first thing he says. Then he goes on. Verse 22, another illustration. He says, no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is destroyed, and so are the skins. But new wine is for fresh wineskins. So in that time, wine was not captured in bottles like it is for us today. Wine was stored and used in old wineskins, and something looked a little bit like a canteen, but it was made of leather. And when the wineskins were used for a long period of time, they would get old, they would get brittle, they wouldn't expand very much. And if you pour new wine into those old wineskins, because they're brittle, the wine begins to ferment, it begins to expand, and it will actually burst, break the wineskins, and the wine spills out, and you lose both the wineskins and the wine. And so Jesus is saying, nobody does that either. That's makes no sense. So why is he saying these things? What does this have to do with anything? And it seems like the point that Jesus is making is that, you know, he's saying that I'm here now, and I've come as the Messiah of the world, and I am not an old wine. I am new wine for you. I am not merely a patch that you can just put on a garment and fix it in just one kind of little isolated part of your life. No, you don't need just a patch. You need a whole new garment. You don't need just old wine. You need brand new wine. What Jesus is saying here is that I'm coming here to do something revolutionary and transformative. I'm not just an add-on to your life. I'm not just one more person coming along like all the rabbis to give a number of prohibitions about how you should observe fasting. He's saying, I am everything to you, or I am nothing. That's the point. You've never seen anything like this before. Don't look at me, Jesus is saying. Don't look at me as just a patch to just help you in one little isolated part of your life. Like, I really need a job. I'll pray to Jesus and he'll get me a job. But then once he gets me the job, I'm going to go on with my life exactly as it was. That's using Jesus as a patch. I really wish I could find a wife. I'll pray to Jesus. Jesus gives me a wife. Thank you, Jesus. And off you go with the rest of your life, not even thinking of him. That's using Jesus as a patch. Jesus is everything or he is nothing. He should have full, total kingship and lordship over every aspect of the life of anyone who comes to him. When I was in eighth grade, I went out for the basketball team, and it got to the end of the practices, and it got to the point where the last cut was about to be made, and I was the last guy there, and so I didn't know if I was going to make the team. And I remember it was after practice once, the coach came to me after a play and said, "Oh, Bannon, do you want to make this team or not?" And apparently, I had just done something stupid on the floor, I guess. I mean, I must not have really given much effort, but something gave him the impression that I wasn't really that interested in making the team. And when he asked me that question, I thought to myself, and I thought, no, I really don't want to make this team. I don't. And that's just when I knew. This is just not worth my time. But here's why I knew that I didn't want to make the team. Because if I made the team, it would require a total overhaul of my schedule and my priorities. I'd have to be there every day after school. I'd have to give my everything to this team. And I didn't want to do that. I didn't want basketball to have that kind of dominance in my life. And what Jesus is saying is, if you want me, you've got to allow me to have that kind of dominance in your life. You got to rearrange your schedule and rearrange your priorities if you're going to live with Jesus as your Lord and Savior. He's not just old wine. He's not just a patch. He is the one who reigns over everything. And so that's out of this controversy over fasting, that's what we see. So one more thing. Now we see a controversy about resting. Controversy about resting. Now, we're not going to go into a lot of detail in these last verses, 23 to 28. I'm actually going to pick up with this again next time and tie it to the beginning of chapter 3 because it's all about the Sabbath. But I just want you to see that this is yet another controversy, and this time it's over this issue, the Sabbath. Sabbath, very important day in the life of a Jewish person at this time. Sabbath instituted at creation is a fourth commandment. The Sabbath, as most people know, is supposed to be a day of rest, not a day of work. We're supposed to rest from all our labors. Well, the Pharisees come in and they kind of mess it up again because the Pharisees, again, they just got all of these additional rules and regulations trying to keep people from violating the Sabbath. Good intention, yes, but I mean, for instance, I've heard of one rule that they had is that you can't spit on the ground on the Sabbath. Because if you spit, the water might go down, the saliva might go down on the ground and germinate with a seed, and then you'd be planting. And that would constitute work. You can't do that. You can't spit. You got to go spit on a rock. But you can't spit in the soil. You know, that's the example of the kind of minutia that the Pharisees would get into. So here's what happens. Verse 23, it's the Sabbath. And here's Jesus, and he's in the grain fields, and they're making their way, the disciples also, and they begin to pluck heads of grain. And the Pharisees, they see this. And they say in verse 24, why are they doing that? Why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath? So they're just picking up little heads of grain. You know, I mean, that's it. Just kind of bringing them into their fingers. And the Pharisees see that and say, they're working. They're violating our laws. I mean, that's the important thing. They're violating our laws, our prohibitions. They're defying our authority here. That is unlawful. And so we'll notice how Jesus responds. Verse 25, he says to them, have you never read? What's he doing? An appeal to Scripture. He's going to 1 Samuel 21, where there's this story of David and his men, and they come along to the temple, and they're very hungry, and they have nothing to eat. They go in the temple, they talk to the priest, can we have some bread? There's this sacred bread, which you guys really shouldn't be eating, but the priest gives it to them anyway, and so David and their men, they eat the bread. And really, that was not what they should have done, but there was a particular need that they had. They were starving, and so they ate the bread. And so what Jesus is doing is he's appealing to that event in 1 Samuel 21 to make the case that it's perfectly okay if we go through the grain, through these fields, these grain fields, and pluck heads of grain. What the Pharisees had done is that they had absolutely drained the Sabbath of every single good thing about it. The Sabbath is not supposed to be a burden to people. It's supposed to be a blessing. In fact, Isaiah 58:13 calls it a delight. Well, to the people living under the Pharisees' influence, the Sabbath was anything but a delight. It was a burden. It was a hassle. Everybody feeling guilty all the time about doing something wrong on the Sabbath. And so Jesus is pointing this out. But for our purposes here this morning, what I want you to see is that the way he resolves this dispute is referring to Scripture. Have you not read? Don't you know your Bibles? That's what Jesus is saying to the Pharisees. Look what happened in 1 Samuel 21. Look what David did. Look how he was taken care of. In his time of need, he was cared for by this bread. And in the same way, we have need here, and it's being cared for, and there is no violation of the Sabbath here. What Jesus says here at the end, verse 27, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. In other words, the rules and prohibitions in the Scripture are not there to constrict and burden us. Those rules, restrictions, commands in the Scriptures are made to bless us. And if that loses sight and these things become more of a burden than they are a delight, then something has gone wrong. But again, bottom line, in this controversy, Jesus refers to Scripture. Our confession of faith, I think, says it very well. The supreme judge by which all controversies of religion are to be determined could be no other but the Holy Spirit speaking in Scripture. So that gets us through the text. Those are the three sources of controversy here: feasting, fasting, and resting. And friends, I want to say to you that if you, in your Christian life, are going to be a person who's going to associate with people differently than you, and you're going to cross bridges and try to reach out to people you disagree with, if you're going to do that, if you're going to live a life that is absolutely dominated by the Lordship of Christ in every aspect of your life, not just one area here or one area there, and if you are going to live your lives fully submitted and devoted to the authority of Scripture in every aspect of your life, controversy will follow you. And that's okay. That's okay. Sometimes controversy erupts. We might think, what did I do wrong? Maybe you did something wrong. You know, I mean, we can be rude and disrespectful and argumentative. We need to examine ourselves. Have I created this controversy unnecessarily? It's a good question to ask. But very often, basic daily devotion to Jesus will cause controversy, particularly in the world in which we live now. And that's certainly what happened to Jesus. To the degree that we're like Jesus, we should expect this to some degree. This controversy got so bad in Jesus' life that it ended up being the reason why he was sent to the cross. Resulted in his death. Resulted in his execution. But let me finish here by just pointing out now what I think is maybe the most controversial thing about this passage. Going back to verse 17, at the very end, what Jesus says, end of verse 17, I came not to call the righteous, but sinners. I think that's the most controversial thing in this whole text. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners. So counterintuitive, isn't it? Because what we do is we spend our entire lives building our resume of all of our accomplishments and all of our achievements and all of our moral efforts and all of our religion and all the sacrifices that we've made. We're constantly through our lives building a resume, hoping we can present it to God and say, oh God, will you now love me? Will you now finally accept me? Look at how good I am. I fast twice a week. I go to church every Sunday. I read my Bible so often. I help the poor. My theology is right on the money. I try so hard. My heart is sincere. I love my wife and kids. I love my husband and kids. I'm a good person. And we present to God our resume. Will you love me? This is so controversial. What does Jesus say? Jesus says, I'm not interested in your resume. What I want you to bring to me is your weakness, your sorrow, your shame, your guilt, your sin, bring me that. And my blood will cover it all. And then we'll start building a resume. Together, we'll start building a resume. But don't come to me with your resume. Come to me in your sin. That's what Jesus is saying, verse 17. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners. Perfect song we're going to sing here. I think it sums this up well. Come, you sinners, band. If you want to come forward, come, you sinners, poor and needy, because Jesus stands ready to save you. God, thank you for your word. Thank you for the wisdom contained in it. Father, please help us as we seek to love those unlike us. Help us as we seek to live under your lordship. Help us as we seek to submit all things to the authority of your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand.
This morning, we are going to consider our last question from the Westminster Larger Catechism as it relates to its instructions on the Lord's Supper. This is something we started over a year ago, And over the last several months, we've been considering what the Catechism has to teach us about how we are to prepare our hearts before coming to the Lord's Supper. What are the requirements during the administration of the supper? And now this morning, what are our duties after receiving the elements of the supper? Now, we might naturally assume that after we take communion, we sing a song, and then we go home, and then we don't think about it for another month. But because God intends to bless us in the partaking of this sacrament, we should consider what benefit, if any, we were able to obtain, and why or why not. So the question in the Catechism, question 175, asks this. What is the duty of Christians after they have received the sacrament of the Lord's Supper? And this is the answer. The duty of Christians after they have received the sacrament of the Lord's Supper is seriously to consider how they have behaved themselves therein, and with what success. If they find quickening and comfort, to bless God for it, beg the continuance of it, watch against relapses, fulfill their vows, and encourage themselves to a frequent attendance on that ordinance. But if they find no present benefit, more exactly, to review their preparation to and demeanor at the sacrament, in both which, if they can approve themselves to God in their own consciences, they are to wait for the fruit of it in due time. But if they see that they have failed in either, they are to be humbled and to attend upon it afterwards with more care and diligence. Now, if we think about this answer, it's fairly straightforward in the guidance that it provides. After you partake of the Lord's Supper, you should seriously consider what spiritual benefit you obtained in it, if any. And so you are to review your preparation. And if you have a benefit in the sacrament, thank God for that. And seek to continue to benefit in subsequent times of partaking of the Lord's Supper. But if you don't sense a benefit in partaking of the Lord's Supper, review your preparation and consider your demeanor and your focused attention during the time of the administration of it. Now remember, the Catechism already deals with instructions for how to prepare our hearts beforehand and our requirements of focusing our attention during the time of the administration of it. So we are to review how we did with that. And if in good conscience we can say that our preparation and our demeanor and focus at the time of the administration of it was sound, then we are to trust God and wait upon Him to bring a proper fruit of blessing from it in due time, whenever that might be. But if when we review our preparation and our conduct during the time of the administration of it, and whether we focused our attention and our hearts upon the administration of it, if we find that to be deficient, then we are to acknowledge that humbly and be more careful and diligent in the future to obtain the spiritual blessing from it, both through our preparation and through our focused attention during the time of the administration of it. The point is this, brothers and sisters. God wants to bless us through this sacrament. He intends for this to be for our spiritual good. And one of the things He wants to impress upon us in this is the assurance of His love for us. That as surely as we can see the elements on this table, this bread that represents the body of Christ crucified on the cross, and this cup that represents His blood poured out on the cross for the forgiveness of sins, as surely as you can see these, as you can touch these, as you can taste these, so also God sent His Son Jesus into the world to live a perfect life, to offer Himself in an atoning death, to be raised again from the tomb, and to ascend into heaven so that all that belongs to Him might be given to you. You see, what this table declares to us is that Jesus gives Himself to you and for you for your salvation so that what belongs to Him is yours. Promised glory, eternal life, pardoned by His blood. He's communicating those things to us so that all that Jesus is ours. He is ours. But as we eat and drink of these elements, we declare not only is Jesus ours as our Lord and our Savior, but that we are His as well. But we can only belong to Jesus, and Jesus can only belong to us as our Lord and Savior by faith. But if your faith is in Jesus, this morning, if you're looking to Him and trusting in Him as your Lord and as your Savior, and if you've been identified as belonging to Him through baptism, either as an infant, a child, or an adult, and if you have declared by profession of faith that He is yours and you are His, then you're invited to come forward this morning and partake of these elements. But if you're here this morning and you're not a Christian, we're glad that you're here. We want you to know that you're welcome here. But we do ask that you refrain from receiving these elements. This sacrament is for Christians. But please know this, that before you leave today, Jesus can be yours and you can be His. And what that means is that His death can be the payment for all of your sins, all of your guilt, all of your condemnation, so that you can be forgiven for all the ways that you've fallen short and all the ways that you have failed. Those can be taken away from you by Jesus. His perfect righteousness can be your perfect righteousness. His resurrection into glory can be the guarantee of your resurrection into glory. His ascension into heaven can guarantee your entrance into heaven. Not because you've done enough, not because you've been able to accumulate enough good works, not because you've been able to walk through enough religious rituals. As Pastor Bob said, not because you've been able to establish a good enough resume. But all this can be yours simply by giving your heart and your life to Jesus. And if you have questions about what that means, what that looks like, what it means to be a Christian, how you become a Christian, please come talk to me, come talk to Pastor Bob, come talk to one of the elders before you leave this morning. But before any of us come forward, as the Catechism has been instructing us, and we should prepare our hearts and examine ourselves so that we can partake in a worthy manner. And one of the ways that we can do that, to attend upon this ordinance in a worthy manner, is to humble ourselves and confess our sins together. So that's what we're going to do by reading the words that you can see on the screen. So let's go before the Lord and read these words together. Lord, we confess our unworthiness, our unrighteousness, our impurity, our weakness, and our guilt before You. And we admit that we deserve condemnation. But in Your grace, You sent Your Son, Jesus, who offered up His body and blood to save sinners. And we look to Him now to find in Him alone our worthiness, our righteousness, our purity, our strength, and our forgiveness. Strengthen our faith and assurance that He was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. Amen. You can take some time now in silence and continue to prepare your hearts. Lord, although we have fallen short of Your glory and transgressed Your commands, we rejoice that You have loved us, that You have shown us mercy and grace, that our guilt has been placed upon Jesus, our substitute, who was wounded for our transgressions, who was crushed for our iniquities, and by His stripes we are healed, we are reconciled to You through His body and blood, represented before our eyes this morning by the elements on this table. Nourish our faith through them, that we might grow in our assurance of Your love and that Jesus lived and died and gave Himself for us. Amen. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, He took bread, and after giving thanks, He broke it and He gave it to His disciples, and He said, "This is My body given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." Likewise, He took the cup, and giving it to His disciples, He said, "This cup is the new covenant in My blood shed for the forgiveness of sins. Drink from it, all of you." If you feel like you're ready to come forward, we invite you to come down one of the aisles directly in front of one of these tables where you can receive the bread and the cup. Hold on to the bread and cup as you return to your seats using either the center aisle or the far outside aisles, leaving these aisles open to those who are yet to be served. And once everyone has received and been seated, we will partake together. But now, for all who are hungering and thirsting for the righteousness of Jesus, come, eat and drink.
Thank you.
Jesus said, "I am the bread of life." Let's partake of the body of Christ together. Jesus said, "Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." Let's drink. Jesus, as you have offered yourself to us, we ask that you would give us grace that we might offer ourselves now completely to you in grateful obedience and love for you and others as we leave this place and go out into the world to bear witness to the reality and power of your transforming grace. Amen.
Please stand as we sing one last song together.
You musicians this morning. If you'd like to talk with somebody this morning, if you have things that you'd like to be prayed for, Stacy Allred will be up here at front, and Brandon Dykstra, who led us in pastoral prayer earlier, will also be up front. But be dismissed now with a good word from God's word to you. Now may the God of peace give you his peace at all times and in every way. Amen.
Praise God.